for those who don't know, the Invasive Species Council, we're an advocacy group, we're a not-for-profit group, donor-funded, and our focus really is on what are the policies, what are the funding, what's the focus that we need governments to put in to make sure that we get action on invasive species, and that's across the invasion curve. But one of the big things we've been working on has been social license. It's been making sure that the tools, that the work that so many people in this room are doing are available, that governments support them, that the broad general public supports them. And hopefully I can give you a few lessons, both from our experience in campaigning to get action in Kosciuszko National Park on feral horses, some of the social research that we've done as well, and some of the insights from that, and then the experience that I've got in dealing with governments across the country, dealing with journalists across the country, and dealing with the community. So there's a few lessons hopefully in this that some of you may have seen from previous talks, but hopefully it's useful. I guess I wanted to start off by saying, yesterday we're all here talking about invasive species, talking about vertebrate pest management. And in the New South Wales Parliament, we had the Shooters and Fishers Party teaming up with the Animal Justice Party to attack the RSPCA and the New South Wales National Parks over probably one of the most professional, the most monitored, the most effective ongoing feral animal eradication program that is going on to save our environment right now, the feral horse culls in Kosciuszko National Park. The lines, the messaging that they were using is the same thing that we're seeing shooters and, hunters, the hunting lobby, and the animal justice or the animal rights lobby putting together in multiple states. They are working together on their messaging, and there is a campaign coming from them to you somewhere around lethal control of feral animals. What am I pressing? Cross. So just a sort of a quick history to some degree of how we got from point one, that in 2018 the New South Wales government said, check it out, we're going to stop culling of wild horses, to point two in 2023 where the New South Wales government said, we are going to work with our national parks, our experts in national parks, to actually effectively manage feral horses. This graph for me says quite a lot. We have had more feral horses removed in Kosciuszko National Park in the last 12 months than the entire 21 years before that combined. And for the first time, the level that's being removed is above the population growth rate. And we know that population growth rate is the key number when it comes to actual effective work on feral animals. If we're doing programs that aren't getting above the population growth rate, then in most cases, we're just killing animals for the sake of it. And it's not worth doing. From that first one, I wanted just to highlight this as well. This came from that New South Wales government press release. A proposal was put on the table by the New South Wales government to allow aerial shooting of feral horses. 11,000 people made submissions. 82% of those submissions were in favour. This wasn't just sign a petition. This was make a submission saying, I am okay with you shooting horses from the air to save our native species and to save that national park. That's a high level action when we're talking about campaign, and we had that many people doing it. So that's a huge change. A lot of things have gone into that. This is just a few things that have gone into it. I'm going to spend most of the time talking about the communications recommendations, but key to it has been a diverse and powerful alliance, and that's been environment groups, it's been unions, it's been recreational groups, fishing groups, it's been skiing groups. Scientists have taken an absolute leading role in this. Indigenous groups have taken a real leading role. We've had MPs come together on this, and also I want to acknowledge the courageous NPWS staff who have faced some horrendous abuse on this. So just some of the things that have gone into many, many years of campaigning. 100 scientists coming together, holding a conference by the Academy of Science and making it absolutely clear where the science sits on this issue. People involved in protest walks, big petitions, written petitions that went into Parliament. Aboriginal people from four major catchments coming together for a water healing ceremony at the headwaters of the Murrumbidgee River. We've taken dozens of politicians up there to see for themselves the damage that's being caused, to make sure that they are there, that they see what's going on and why it matters. We've had hundreds of high-profile media stories, and getting the media educated on this issue has been absolutely key to this, because we know often media, they are not engaged on these issues. They're having a passing reference to the issue. They're having to report really quickly, so building up that level of media literacy. And then that last one there, which is what I'm really going to talk to everyone about, clear, consistent and effective communication on this issue that secures the social license. So the bad news, as I said, a campaign to stop aerial shooting could be coming your way, and we can't have complacency anywhere in the country on that. As I said, the recreational shooting lobby, animal rights lobby, they are working together with this. And many elements of this debate, they mirror what we've seen in the climate wars or the anti-vax debate. They are culture wars at their heart. Science and evidence is ignored, it's manipulated or it's made up. And interest groups pretend to be genuine and serious, but their underlying motive is to stop action altogether. And that needs to be recognised. These are not people who want action to occur. And I put those two groups together very deliberately. The main bad faith narratives that we see, and these are the narratives that we see consistently across the country. So alternatives, this idea that, that we can use either trapping and rehoming, or that we can use fertility control, things like this, which have been proven not to work, that will not get to that scale above the population growth rate or will take decades to have an impact. That's one. Two is this eat the problem narrative, this idea that, oh, if we just go out and hunt it and everyone gets and eats that, the deer instead of eating beef, that's going to get on top of the problem. Market-based solutions have not worked anywhere when it comes to feral animal control. And anyone who tells you they do will not be able to point to any. I'm very sceptical of the market-based solutions we've heard here, because we know that individual animal removal does not lead to getting above that population growth rate and often creates incentives to increase the number of those feral animals in the landscape. Questioning the numbers, this happens time and again. There are actually a lot less because people find it intuitively difficult to understand that you won't see all the feral animals in a landscape. So it's an easy anti-science attack that can be used. Carcass concerns, why are you leaving those carcasses in the landscape? Why are you killing foals or baby animals? The pursuit times, we're seeing this a lot. Pursuit times are too long. Gut shots shouldn't be allowed. We should only have headshots only, or that there's too many shots, that we shouldn't have overshooting. And these narratives are false narratives, but they are used consistently by the hunting lobby and the animal rights lobby everywhere. And they are working together. So let's be clear on that. Good news. So that feral horse campaign in Kosciuszko shows us what's possible. And the public and politicians are receptive, and this I've said here, to aerial shooting, and I think it applies to a lot of other lethal control techniques for feral animals, if A, they understand the problem that's being caused, B, they hear an emotionally intelligent response which frames this issue as a difficult but a necessary choice. This is important. It is not nice to kill animals. We cannot be gung-ho about killing animals. We should not be out there putting out media releases from government departments saying, yay, we killed 100,000 pigs. That was extremely bad communications from the New South Wales government going out and saying that, because it says nothing about why we did it or what impact that killing 100,000 pigs has had. Poor policy as well as poor messaging. They need to believe that alternatives have been tried and explored. If we are not looking at some of those alternatives, then that is something that the public don't understand in terms of the sort of realistic approach to trying to avoid lethal control. And also operators being professional and using approved methods. That's extremely important here. Professional campaigns are what we need. Amateur campaigns are not going to work when it comes to managing feral animals. Engaging trusted non-government voices, really important. Groups like us have been essential around the country to making sure that you secure that license. Governments cannot secure social license on their own. Departments are extremely insular, in my experience, across the entire country. They are insular to and it loses the social license because of that. We need to bring non-government voices in. The media needs to be educated and activated. As I said, media often do not have the resources, the depth of knowledge on these issues. And if we are not educating them, teaching them, engaging seriously in the issues that they have or the questions that they bring up, if we're dismissing them, we will not shift that perspective. And we need to call out those bad faith narratives when they come up. We don't just leave them alone. We call them out. So I just wanted to take through quickly, so just some broader polling data for you just to get a sense of where we're at. So here, there's just some polling that was done by the Australian Conservation Foundation a couple of years ago. There's been more up-to-date polling that's done, but that tells us pretty much a similar story, which is that people care about the environment, but there's a large proportion of Australians who don't feel a deep connection to that environment. That's important because that informs their level of care. They see it as part of the identity, but they don't feel particularly connected, is one thing. Secondly, when it comes to extinctions, which is something we talk about a lot and we're very concerned about when it comes to invasive species, people care about extinctions, but they're not aware of the extent to which Australia is leading the world on extinctions, and invasive species are the number one driver of them. And finally here, most people think nature in Australia is in a pretty good state. And that tells us that we have a job to do to motivate action, because it isn't. But we need to know that underlying for most people is that we are in a pretty good state. This one here, this is much more recent. The Biodiversity Council did some polling this year, which they've put out here. But I just grabbed four of their things from that one, just to show you, you know, there's a majority support for all of those issues you see on screen there. But humanely killing non-native invasive species has the lowest of those ones. It's still 60% support, 32% without a opinion, and 8% opposing, but it is lower than a lot of the other environmental issues that we have. So we did some research, which I'll just quickly talk to look at the messaging around this issue. It involved two things for us, some quantitative polling questions that we asked, and then some qualitative focus group work that we did. We did it across a range of, you know, feral horses, feral deer, cats, citizen science work that we were doing. But I'll just share some of the insights from that. This one here on the perceptions on environment issues tells us a similar story to that last slide. So for 89% of people, the destruction caused by invasive plants and animals is important. But in terms of that very important, which is where we get into motivation side of things, it's lower than it is for extinctions or water and air quality and things like that. You can see climate change there has a higher number in the very important, but also a higher number in the not that important or not important at all. That tells us, I think, that the culture war in that space is a lot stronger than it is in the other spaces. I think if you probably, if there was a big logging campaign going on to stop native forestry, as we've seen in some areas, but I think when this was taken, that wasn't as high as it is. We'll probably start to see that not important at all number tick up as that sort of public debate occurs. A few things here. A big issue we have on invasive species is younger people. Basically, there's an inverse relationship on the issue of invasive species to what we see with other environment issues. So on most environment issues, if you're younger or you're female, you're more likely to be worried about it. When it comes to invasive species, it's the opposite. If you're younger or female, you're less likely to be worried and you're less likely to be supportive of lethal control. So that's really important for how we message, how we talk about these things. And you can see there 41% of people 18 to 34, large group, don't see invasive species as one of our significant threats to our environment, despite it being the highest driver of extinction. And one thing for me that stood out last week was, and I'm not having a go at them, but I think it says something to us. The Wentworth group of scientists brought out a really excellent report looking at what would $7 billion a year for nature achieve in terms of fixing Australia. They got, did National Press Club, got a huge amount of media about this. In that $7 billion a year figure that they put out, it didn't include any funding for invasive species action. That tells us something about where this issue sits in the environment sector. And that's problematic and something we need to shift. Similarly, if you go to political affiliation, it's actually quite different as well. You can see there, the Greens are the least likely to agree or somewhat agree about invasive species being one of our most significant threats to the environment. So that's sort of the opposite to what a lot of us would expect. In terms of perception of humane culling of vertebrate pest control, you can see there in those numbers what I just said in terms of the gender and the age gap, a lot higher support among men and among older age groups. I'm going to flick through quickly. There's just some, just in terms of time. This one's key though. When it comes to framing action as a choice, 80% of people are happy, support the following statement that Australian native plants and animals have greater cultural importance than introduced species, and only 20% say that introduced species should be treated the same. That's a really important insight for our communications. And what we found in our focus groups, it was that when presented with this choice between protecting our native species or our invasive species, and this was at the end of us delivering the most hardcore opposition messaging and images and photos that we could, still 64 out of 68 people in those focus groups ended up saying we should manage those invasive species, including through lethal methods, once they were given that choice. So here's my comms recommendations in the 8 minutes left. Visuals are really important. One of the things that we found in our focus groups and in our engagement generally has been people often understand quite intuitively how a fox or a cat causes environmental damage. They don't understand how a deer or a horse or a pig causes environmental damage. So you have to paint that picture every time you talk about it. The words I use, trash, trample, pollute. You'll hear me in every interview I do say those three words, and that's about painting the picture. Because if we don't have those words in what we're saying, people don't understand why a deer or a pig or a horse causes environmental damage. We do, because we spend a lot of time thinking about it, but most people don't, and that's something we need to change. Visuals are a great way to tell that story as well. I'll flick through that. So here's my messaging highlights. Emphasize skilled and trained teams and supportive voices like the CSIRO, the RSPCA, or environment groups. Acknowledge those alternatives have been considered but proven ineffective. We need to acknowledge that work has gone on. Frame invasive species management as a choice between action and inaction. Engage early in that choice between natives and invasives. So when you're starting the process of announcing a new program, start right away with talking about what it's going to do for the environment and making that clear choice there. Highlighting extinction is really important. This is something people connect to. And the cute or iconic species that are impacted is more important than talking about that destruction caused by invasives. I said we've got to paint the picture, but actually talking about what's going to be impacted is more important in terms of those animals than just talking about the you know, here's a picture of pig damage, something like that. Visuals, showing empathy is really important. And that's not a trick. That is because all of us should also feel a degree of empathy to the idea that we're having to kill sentient beings. That is not nice. That is something that's difficult. It's something, and we need to acknowledge that. It's something that people are going to have intuitive reaction that feels uncomfortable to, because people care about our environment, and these animals are, you know, are part of our environment. The problem is that what they are doing is sending our native species extinct. They are trashing, trampling, they are polluting our rivers, they're spreading weeds around. So this is the issue. It's not that killing isn't difficult. And don't blame animals for their actions. The worst thing you can do if you're the Federal Minister for the Environment, is to, whether you're Liberal or Labor, because both of them have done it, is decide you're going to declare a war on feral cats. That is bad messaging. It should not happen. We're not at war with feral cats. We're going to take action to make sure that feral cats don't continue to kill billions of our native animals every year. And then that last one, considering elevating the voices of women or young people to connect more broadly. This is something we don't do very well. What doesn't work? Going into your shell, not communicating and keeping messages high level, not engaging with people's concerns, not acknowledging that they are real, doesn't work. Trying to appease some of these bad faith actors doesn't work either. I see time and again governments go and engage with shooting lobby, go and engage with animal rights lobby because they are the ones who are talking to them and are concerned, and not engaging with the general public, not engaging with environment groups who tend to be really poor at knowing about invasive species. And that's a problem. These bad faith actors are not interested in feral animal control. They are not interested in your arguments. They are not there to do anything but stop feral animal control occurring. Celebrating numbers or gung-ho triumphalism, as I call it, does not work for the public. We do not need to be going out there saying, yay, we killed a pig, how good are we? Check out this photo of me next to a dead pig. That doesn't help this work at all. I know some people love doing that, but it doesn't help the social license. And then we also found quite strongly, framing focused on economics, biosecurity, or humour don't work at all. And humour in particular turns people off very quickly in this space because it's not emotionally acknowledging how difficult this is. So humour is not a good space to use in this. Prepare for the attacks. Support those external voices. This is essential, and it's something that I think government departments need to do a lot better. In particular, if you're going to start doing a serious, culling, if you're going to be in South Australia and decide that you're going to eradicate all deer, fantastic. But who is on your side? And it's not just the farming lobby that you need to be talking to. One of the issues we have in the environment movement or environment activism is that the climate narrative and the climate imperative has hollowed out environment groups' capacity to engage on environment issues that aren't climate. And that means that you need to upskill them on these issues. That's not because they're bad or because they're, a waste of space and, why do we just have these environment groups going after coal? It's because this thing is an existential threat to our societies and young people are directly engaged and worried about that. But from where we were 20 years ago or 15 years ago in terms of environment groups, their level of environmental literacy is a lot lower. And that is really important to know. And that means that it is the responsibility of people working in this space to go out and help them because they will be your champions. They will understand these narratives and they will be really important voices in the media. Engaging those groups, engaging directly with the media on your plans, not just media releases, but actually meet with the media, take them to the places. Don't feel scared to take the media to see what you're going to go and do. Because that level of literacy of knowledge is low. Don't try to, I said this, so it's a bit of a repetition. They will try to present reasonable arguments, but it's really important to have a response to those arguments, but it is not your job, I don't think, to go and try and appease those groups at every point. Don't try and go, we're going to do a 10,000-year scientific study on pigs for nothing just because the hunting group wants us to. Like, what is that for? I heard it talked about yesterday. What are we going to achieve with this 10,000-year thing? Like, it's greenwashing for hunting groups who don't want to see effective feral animal control. I've seen them time and again try and frustrate government action on invasive species because they want their pigs or their deer to be out there building up in numbers, and they know that if they get 5 years of government inaction, the numbers will be out of control, and we won't be able to get on top of it. That's the aim. The aim is delay you for 5 years till the population growth is too high. Look, my time's up. You've heard hopefully some controversial bits there. Last one I say, have your frequently asked questions ready to go at the start. That's really important so you can answer the questions. Thank you very much.